Welcome back to Genetics on Catalyst University. My name is Kevin Tokoff. Please make sure to like this video and subscribe to the channel for future videos and notifications. We hopefully know that all chromosomes have genes on them. And one of the most interesting chromosomes or sets of chromosomes to talk about are the sex chromosomes, typically denoted number 23 in humans, and those are the X and Y chromosomes. And hopefully we know that at least in mammals, particularly humans and cats as shown right here, females have the genotype XX, meaning they have two X chromosomes, and males have the genotype XY, meaning they have one X chromosome and one Y chromosome. And in this video, I want to start with posing a question about this cat right here, which is a special kind called a calico, which has these multiple colors that appear to be in random places, emphasis on the word random, as we'll talk about, and ask why is that? To understand this, we need to talk about X chromosome inactivation and production of what are called Barr bodies. So over here on the left side of the screen, this is the nucleus of a typical female healthy cell. Okay, it has the genotype XX, meaning it has two X chromosomes, and one of the X chromosomes is shown over here on the left side, and the other is here on the right. And you'll notice that both of those DNA molecules, those chromosomes, look very different. The X chromosome on the left over here is in its uncoiled chromatin form. And this is what allows the chromatin or the DNA molecule to be expressed, meaning genes are transcribed and all that stuff. This is how the DNA molecule will look for most of the cell's lifetime. It's only during mitosis that it coils up and looks like this down here. Then you'll notice the other X chromosome, which has been pushed all the way to the right side of the nucleus against the wall, or the membrane, I should say. It's all dense, coiled up. It's essentially been compacted into a little blob and pushed to the side of the nucleus. This is what we call a Barr body. And you might be able to guess that this Barr body that I'm showing right here is the inactive X chromosome. Okay, so that actually brings up a point. In all, let's say, females that are healthy with a genotype XX, one of those X chromosomes is going to be active, and the other one is going to be inactivated by mechanisms that we'll talk about more specifically in another video. And this inactivation condenses it into what's called a Barr body. Here's a micrograph image of a nucleus right here, and what you can see is this very dark spot on one wall of the nucleus. This is the Barr body. This is the inactivated X chromosome. This Barr body, it's still the X chromosome, it's just been modified to condense it down, and no genes on this in general are expressed. Only genes on this chromatin-activated X chromosome are going to be expressed, okay? And the way that we typically denote that is if we want to say XX, we can put a little subscript A to denote which of the chromosomes is activated, and then any other is going to have this I for inactivated, and that X sub I is going to denote the Barr body, okay? Now moving over to the male over here, we notice that the male has a genotype XY, and we typically don't need to do anything other than that. This in red, this is the X chromosome, and then this in blue, the smaller baby chromosome, that's the Y. But you notice over here in the male nucleus, this is a typical healthy male, they have no Barr body. Well, why is that? So here's a general statement. Every somatic cell that has two copies of every chromosome has to have exactly one active X chromosome. Well, over here in the male, that's definitely satisfied. There's only one X chromosome to start with, so there's no other chromosome to inactivate, and then this X chromosome is the activated one, okay? Over here in the healthy female who has two X chromosomes, there has to be one activated X chromosome, and the other one is inactivated and turned into a Barr body, okay? And that's the principle of X chromosome inactivation. They're inactivated into a Barr body, leaving only one activated chromosome. And these are the cases for a normal healthy female and a normal healthy male. But now, let's consider what happens if we have some of these strange sex chromosome genotypes that result from non-disjunctions that we talked about in a separate video, so go watch that. And those are disorders like Klinefelter syndrome, Turner syndrome, then we have another one called triple X syndrome, sometimes called superwoman or superfemale syndrome. So let's talk about those, and let's think about the number of activated X chromosomes and the number of Barr bodies that would be produced. And this will all fit into what's called the Lyon hypothesis, named after the scientist who discovered this. or at least proposed this. And the idea is that all but one X chromosome in any sex chromosome genotype is going to be inactivated. All but one. So that means that there has to be one X chromosome that's active, and any other X chromosomes that are present are going to be inactivated. And so what we can think of is that the number of inactivated X chromosomes, or the number of Barr bodies, is always going to be the number of X chromosomes minus one. So if we had a weird case, which this will never happen, but if a human managed to somehow get 10 X chromosomes, then they would have 9 Barr bodies, because 10 minus 1 is 9. So only one of those X chromosomes would be activated, and all other 9 of them would be inactivated to Barr bodies. So if we consider over here this unusual male case of a genotype XXY, this is actually Klinefelter syndrome. So this male has an extra X chromosome. So again, the X chromosomes are in red, and any Y chromosomes are in blue. Well, they have to have one of these X chromosomes activated. That's this one over here. Here's the Y chromosome in blue, but then the other X chromosome is inactivated into a Barr body, which again, as you see here, pushed to one of the walls of the nucleus. And when we denote this very specifically, we can actually, again, say that one of these chromosomes, the X chromosome that's active, is X sub A. It has an X sub I due to the Barr body, and then Y. Okay? So this is the genotype of someone who's Klinefelter syndrome, and we can say they have one Barr body because they've got two X chromosomes, so the number of Barr bodies is 2 minus 1, or 1. All right? Let's look at the next one. This is the genotype of somebody who has Turner syndrome. Now, what this O means is that there's no other chromosome. In fact, what you could do is just put X, but sometimes you'll see this written as XO, and this is someone who only has one X chromosome, and they're phenotypically female. This X chromosome is active, as you can see, but there's no other X chromosome to inactivate. So that one X chromosome they have is just going to be activated by default. Okay? And so if you think about how many Barr bodies they should have, well, they just have one X chromosome. 1 minus 1 is 0. So they're not going to have any Barr bodies in this case. There's no X chromosome to inactivate because you have to have this one activated. Now, if we consider this one over here, which is our triple X syndrome, or super female, or super woman syndrome, this genotype has 3 X chromosomes, all right? So one of those X chromosomes has to be activated, which is the one you see right here, okay? But the other two would have to be inactivated and converted into Barr bodies. And you see them both pushed here against the walls of the nucleus. And so if we wanted to be very specific, we've got X sub A, one X chromosome that's activated, then these other two, X sub I, are two Barr bodies that are going to be inactivated. And again, we can figure it out through this formula. We've got 3 X chromosomes, so if we subtract 1 to get 2, that's our number of Barr bodies, and certainly we've got 2 Barr bodies. So it's important for the purpose of test questions and things like that to be able to think about how many Barr bodies would be present in some of these strange genotypes. Now, I don't actually have it written here, but if you ever had Jacob syndrome, which is actually a genotype, they're male, they'll have XYY, so 2 Y chromosomes. Just of interesting note, the Y chromosome, if there's any extra of them, are actually not inactivated. So you could have potentially 3 Y chromosomes, it would be extremely rare, but if you for some reason had 3 Y chromosomes, all 3 of them would be active. You might have some issues that develop later in life, but all 3 of those Y chromosomes would be active. You do not have Barr bodies for any extra Y chromosomes. That leads us back to our initial question, which is, what is the deal with calico cats? Well, if you notice, they got these white spots right here, which we'll come to last. But the main feature of these calico cats is they have seemingly random patterns, and they actually are random, of orange and dark brown. Okay? Now, the chromosome that encodes this brown or orange is on the X chromosome, and these cats have 2 X chromosomes, which begs the question, are they all female? And the answer generally is yes. Calico cats are all going to be female. There is a rare exception to this, and that's if you have a male cat that has 2 X chromosomes. That is, you have a cat with Klinefelter syndrome. So if you have a cat with Klinefelter syndrome, there's a very rare chance they can be a calico cat because they have two X chromosomes. They're still male because they have the Y, but if you have a cat that has Klinefelters, they actually have a very slim chance of actually having a calico as well. But in general, we're just going to consider them all female. Now suppose we have this somatic cell, which came from this cat's tail right here, all right, as you can see. The tail's brown. Well, the way you have a calico cat is one of the X chromosomes, there's a gene on it, and it's actually the same gene, just different alleles of that gene. But one allele of that gene encodes for yellow, and the other allele of that gene codes for brown. Well, remember that when there's two X chromosomes, one of the chromosomes is inactivated, right? But it's random sometimes as to which one is inactivated. Random. So let's say the tail region right here of this calico cat randomly inactivates this X chromosome with the orange allele. So that means that region, anywhere where this chromosome right here is inactivated to a Barr body, the brown allele is going to be expressed. All right? But now consider the case of this cat's abdomen, or looks like kind of his butt or her butt right here, a little bit on this paw and then some on the face and her left ear, it looks like. In those regions of the body, it seems that the brown allele, that X chromosome, is inactivated. Well, if that X chromosome is inactivated, then the brown allele cannot be expressed, but instead the orange allele will be expressed. And so what you get is a seemingly random arrangement of brown and orange all over the body of this calico cat. And due to the random inactivation of the X chromosomes, you get this kind of patterning. Okay? Although it's not well understood, you know, why there seems to be a pretty large region of orange and a pretty large region of brown, but in general, it's just assumed to be random. Now, the other question is, why do they have these white spots? So on her right paw, it looks like kind of this chin or chest area right here. Why is that white? Well, it turns out that there's another chromosome. It's not a sex chromosome or not an X chromosome. It's an autosome that actually encodes another gene for white. And it turns out that whenever this gene is expressed, it's actually dominant over either the orange or the brown. And so if any region of this cat expresses this autosome gene, this dominant gene for white fur, or at least it's kind of like a blanking type of gene, meaning these will not be expressed orange or brown, then orange and brown are not expressed because that gene is dominant and you have no color or just white. Okay? And that's ultimately what leads to the pattern of colors you see on calico cats, because you have this random inactivation of X chromosomes, meaning random production of Barr bodies, and therefore you have a random arrangement of colors. In fact, if you look at any calico cat, they're going to have a different arrangement of orange and brown and white. And actually, if you look at twins, calico cat twins from the same litter, they'll also have different patterns of these colors. Okay? And even when they clone a cat, which they have done successfully, the patterning is still different. So it really seems that this inactivation of these X chromosomes is truly random. So hopefully you learned a lot about X chromosome inactivation, why calico cats are the way they are, what we see in terms of Barr bodies in normal, healthy females and males, and then also in some of these strange genotypes where we have non-disjunctions that lead to these aneuploidies, right? Please make sure to like this video and subscribe to the channel for future videos and notifications.